It just means in place of the altar. Just in place of the altar. And it's a simpler way, but most Latin churches, or most Western churches will have, the altar will be fixed, and we fix with relics within it, or an altar stone. And that's what it symbolizes. That's what it symbolizes.
The altar stone is...
Usually the altar stone does have relics within it. This one probably doesn't, but it all, like I said, it's a symbol of Christ as the altar of sacrifice too. That's why the stone is. That's why the stone is.
Where would one acquire the relics?
Well, I happen to have brought with me a whole array. Which would you?
You can buy it on eBay.
I don't like that. I don't trust them. I don't trust them. I don't trust them to buy them on the eBay. I really don't trust these people. That they're real, you know.
So how would you?
Usually, you know, if you have someone that you know, and you know me, so if you in our diocese, 10 years ago, we had a priest in our diocese who lived in Plymouth, New Hampshire. He was a professor, but he belonged to what this obscure organization called the International Association of Relic Holders or something like that. Something weird. Oh my gosh, it's weird. But he belonged to it. So he had like 200 pieces of people, you know, in the relic. They're not just lying out, they're like bones. No, they're in little containers usually, gilded containers. And they're the bones, you know, of different saints, of people that are Christian heroes and things that have died. So I remember when he died and I went into his house. Right, I was like, and I looked around. And his brother, who was his executor, said, "Take as many as you want." And he ended up telling me twice. I said that I'm looking for people because they're all usually written in Latin, so you have to decipher who the name is of who this. You know. So they had apostles, he had everybody, you know, all types of people in there, you know. So I'm picking things out, putting them down, putting them over here, putting them over there. And so I have a number of those relics that have been.
So if we wanted to get them, all we have to do is tap you on the shoulder.
And like say, can we have one for our altar? And I'd be going, aw.
Cancel Father Kalish.
Yes, Father Kalish. Father Kalish is always scared to ask me about these things.
He has a vestry that will push on.
I love him dearly because I think Father Kalish, you've been to my home before, haven't you? Too,
I have not. Yeah.
Oh, you haven't?
No.
Oh, okay. Because I keep forgetting which priests have gone to my home and they see, because my private chapel in my own house houses the relics.
Oh, okay.
So it looks, like the people, the bishop has gone, the bishop, Bishop Marsh has gone. He's gone in there and go, whoa, where'd you get all this? I said, well, priests die in the diocese, I get their stuff. You know, they, all that stuff comes to me. But yes, remind me, make a petition, I'll be happy to get one for your altar.
All right.
So that'll be fine. Yeah. Okay. So we looked at how, like I said, very, very traditional. If you go into other Western churches like modern Roman Catholic Church and things like that, you'll see that it's very different. You know, they've moved the table usually out. There are no rails hedging it in. There, you know, it's somewhat similar, but this is traditional. This is traditional. The two Eucharistic lights, and you have the office lights in the back, or the high, or the solemn service lights in the back. That's what those are. So then go, okay, so the very next page, just for your information, like you asked me what things were, and that was before Shirley had brought in the pages that we have now. It puts everything, and everything we have that we just talked about is right there. And it tells you how to put it all together. You have your chalice, and it tells you why the chalice is there, and the purificator, and the paten, and the pall, which is this beautiful piece of embroidered linen, which is here, which is very, everything that you see has a place. And the pall was originally because you didn't want animals or bugs falling into your chalice. Mm-hmm. Or anything falling into your chalice that wasn't supposed to be in there. That's why you cover it. right? Because we all know things fall in. And I remember when I was a child, I saw the priest celebrate Mass once, and a fly was flying around, and he picked up the pall and he hit the thing, and the thing went diving right down into the chalice. And I remember I was looking, I was watching, I saw them, and and, you know, he looked in there, too. It had already been consecrated, though. So he drank it. He drank with the fly in it. Because he just, that's what you do. One of the old and father... I don't know if your missal has it, Father. Did your missal have a section on acts, on peculiar accidents in the liturgy? And it talks just about that. It talks about bugs or something that would fall into your chalice. It says, if you can consume it without vomiting, consume it. If not, you got to fish it out, put it somewhere, burn it up, and then throw the ash and bury the ashes somewhere. You know, it's yes, Father.
Father Davis, when I was reading, told about the acolyte, Father. If you spare, it was, I don't know whether it's now or not, but if anything happened, the consecrated wine got spilled on an altar linen, that part was supposed to be cut out and burned.
Well, if it...
And this, wanting the altar boy to be very careful that he didn't get some of the consecrated wine spilled on him.
I'll have to take you out and burn you.
Part of you.
That's right. I'm gonna burn you. Burn you. But no. Those rubrics, like I said, to read them, you sometimes laugh, but you have to realize that they're written in a manner because it's to remind you that what you're doing is just not sitting at your, you know, it's just not sitting in a diner. It's not sitting at your dinner table. That what you're doing, and would remind the priest to be very, very careful. And those, yes, usually if it was spilled on an altar linen, you could take the altar linen off and you can clean it, and you can pour water. The whole process is rather complicated. Pour water all through it until it's no longer, you can no longer see the stain. But it was like if it was a carpet, you know, if it was a carpet, you know, the carpeting in the sanctuary, you spilled on the carpet in the sanctuary, then you know, if you can't get it up, you're supposed to cut it out, you know, and then, you know, so burn it so people couldn't do it. But you know, even yeah, but you know, but that's it's all because of the great importance of what we are doing to remind us that it's not just something, you know, that it, like some people do, like just having snacks, having hors d'oeuvres at your dinner party, right? Here, have a cracker. Here, have some wine. It's not that. It's more than that. It is Christ himself who was deigned to come to us, so that it always, though it's written in the Missal, because it's to remind the priest, to caution the priest, you're supposed to be very, very careful. Yeah, but I actually did one thing in distributing communion. I actually did the host. I forgot what I did. The host fell onto a woman. You know, and the rubrics say the rubrics actually cover that. And I remember reading them once. Now, so, you know, all of a sudden your mind flashes back. It says, the priest is not to retrieve the Eucharist if it falls onto a woman's chest, right? She is to herself do it. And it says, and she may retire to the sacristy, where she may. He gave a whole thing. I'm reading, you know, I remember reading it when I was younger and laughing about it, right? Well, you laugh about it till it happens to you. And then you're like, and you're like, okay, but I'll just, okay, yeah, I'm done. Yeah, there you go. Oh, okay, that's enough. Yes.
Father Tutor, I was thinking, I've been thinking about the wine cruet and how when we never totally empty, we refill, there's usually some left and refill. Is that
you mean? You mean for here?
Yes.
No, it's not consecrated, so that's the one here is not, that's not, you know, it's not put on the altar to for consecration,
right.
Part of
but
it.
But is there any significance to never emptying the cruet and washing it? And we do that. But the wine is always added to what's already there over years and years.
You haven't washed that one in years?
No,
we alternate.
You want to kill it?
We just have to prove it and then wash it.
Oh, yeah.
We do wash it.
Because we used to alternate between the two, the water and the wine.
The one thing about is the wine.
Yeah, but we used to often when Father Hendron was on, we would always alternate between the two, so that the water would the one that we used for water one Sunday was used for wine the next Sunday.
Yes, that's so what we used to do. Yes,
yeah.
But the wine is always added to.
Until we change it. If that were part of an older tradition.
But we never change it, we always add to it.
Well, the wine is not quite, like he said, the wine hasn't been consecrated.
It's just like if you have a bottle of wine at home that sits around.
Yeah, you're welcome to pour it out.
Okay. Yeah, it's just wine.
I just like that idea that it's been going on.
Oh, because it's about a continuing. See,
yeah.
Actually, you just brought that up. You just made me think way back into older customs, okay? And in the church in Rome, there used to be the custom of, what was it called? Okay, I'll explain it when it is. But I don't remember what the fermentum, that's what it was called. I think that's what it was called. And what happened was, and it used to be in the rubric of consecration of a bishop way back when. And what it meant was that during when the Bishop of Rome celebrated a solemn mass, wherever he celebrated in Rome, he would consecrate enough of the elements, and then there would be subdeacons who would come up at the time of Holy Communion with linen napkins in their hands, and the Bishop of Rome would take a piece of the Eucharist, place in each napkin, the subdeacon would put it up, hold it close, and then run to the local churches that were celebrating Eucharist at the same time, because it was a symbol of unity with the bishop. Because at one time, only the bishop would be celebrant, is the high priest of his diocese. And whenever he celebrates, all the clergy of the diocese should be there with him as he celebrates. But this was to show that even though a person was not present at the Mass of the Bishop or the Bishop of Rome, he would send a particle of Eucharist that they would then put into the chalice to symbolize communion with him. So in the older rituals for the consecration of a bishop, there was the rubric that said, and the bishop is to consecrate a sufficient amount of the sacrament so that during when he celebrated the next, after his consecration, he celebrated the different Eucharist, he would then add a piece of that Eucharist to the chalice after consecration to symbolize the unity with the consecrators who had consecrated a bishop. So
connectedness.
Yeah, it connected them. That's what you're talking about too when you put wine that was used for a, not consecrated, but used for a sacrifice. It's a continuous, kind of usage. But that's an old innovation, which you remember, from all these old rubrics, getting there. But that was one of the older customs that no longer is in existence, because once churches started getting farther and farther away from the episcopal seat, they'd have to run really quick and really far, bringing the Eucharist to another presbyter or another. An assistant bishop who's celebrating the Eucharist. But the beautiful part of it is, it symbolizes unity, the unity of the faith that you have, that you are offering the same. So that's actually a very good issue to bring up right now. Wherever the Eucharist is celebrated, wherever there is apostolic succession, whether the East or the West, any priest that stands within, who is a priest of the New Testament, the Eucharist is the same. Whether in a Greek church, a Latin church, the traditional Anglican churches, if the Eucharist is celebrated by a priest, it is the same Christ in the same mode within all of these churches. And that's something that people somewhat forget about is that no matter if a Mass is being celebrated in Rome, no matter if it's being celebrated in Istanbul, no matter if it's being celebrated even here in this place or at our cathedral farther down in Amherst, the Eucharist is the same. It is Christ dwelling among his people because that is what he wishes to do in the Most Holy Eucharist. So remember that. I think that's why, also, like I said, after they stopped the fermentum, they stopped sending the Eucharist out. But it was a good symbol that this is, we are all united in the one bread and the one cup. That's what that means. Okay, perfect. Okay, so any other questions about what we see here?
Yeah, what's the altar cards?
Okay, altar cards. And they're used, we don't, I have most things memorized, so I don't use them anymore, but they're, what they are here are cheat sheets. They're cheat sheets. So, just like, they'd be about the size of this piece of paper, and they'd be written over here what to say when you're washing your hands. You know, when the priest is washing his hands, if there's a prayer that he says washing his hands. So, they would, usually, be against the candle, one candlestick here, and then the big one would be right here in front of the tabernacle, which had like the Gloria and Chelsea's, the Credo, and the words of institution. So the priest didn't, if he didn't know them, he wouldn't have to be looking at the missal here. He could be looking straight ahead as he said them. You know, they were right there. So what they are is they're just big cheat sheets. That's what they are. And I don't use them. I know some places that do, and they're beautiful. Some places are big, beautiful, gorgeous looking things. And but some places were done at Altar Society. When the Altar Society did them by hand, then, you know, did them in calligraphy and gilded work. Beautiful. I tried to get some once, but they stopped me as I was running. You know, those little Altar Society ladies can run fast.
I know. They're protecting that altar.
That's right.
Wouldn't a lot of that have been before the first Book of Common Prayer, that the priest took the service from several books?
Mm-hmm.
So therefore he had these cheat sheets.
Yeah.
Bishop Ford,
yes, down in Sanford.
He did a lecture. I don't remember whether it was a clericus or just what. He had these cheat sheets, cards, all the cards.
Mm-hmm.
I think I have a copy of them.
Yeah, they do. And I've seen a lot of beautiful ones. And also, we have, if you go to a traditional Latin Mass, they need them. Because, you know, you can't, you know, Latin's kind of hard. So you have, in traditional Latin churches, you will have them. They'll always be up there because your memory is failed. But I memorized, like, the Lavado prayer, the psalm. I memorized that so I don't have to read it anymore. And the prayers, you know, other prayers, too. So that's, but that's the reason why they were there. That's the real reason why they were there.
And it says that the tabernacle is usually covered with a veil.
Mm-hmm.
Is that practice? I mean, we could read on.
You can have a veil. I have I use a veil in ours in the penitential seasons. Because ours is gold. We have a gold tabernacle. Oh. So in the penitential seasons, I have an ox blood one and then a purple one. And I cover it because it's gold. But the veil is really from the Hebrew Testament. You know, it symbolizes, you know, the veiling of the veil in the temple. Because God, to show that God was present, in the temple, there was a veil placed in front of it. So it would veil God's presence as a symbol of that he dwelt there. But as I opened your tabernacle today, the consecrated elements on the inside are covered with a linen veil.
Okay.
And that's just as that's the same thing. So, like when I went into the tabernacle, I saw that the elements were covered.
It doesn't need to be visible to the outside.
No, because they're veiled on the inside.
Yeah.
and that's perfect. So right. I kind of looked it up and looked inside and go, that's, oh, guess what? There's food here.
Yes.
So we will break right now for lunch, and then we will continue right after lunch. Okay? Thank you.